The lesson for the day is written in the first chapter of Genesis. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty, darkness was all over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. God saw that the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be a vault between the waters to separate the water from the water." So God made the vault and separated the water under the vault from the water above it. And it was so. God called the vault sky, and there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the water under the sky be gathered in one place, and let dry ground appear." And it was so. He called the dry ground land, and the gathered waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants and trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to the various kinds." And it was so. The land produced vegetation, plant-bearing seed according to their kinds, and trees bearing fruit with seed in it according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the vault of the sky to separate the day from the night, and let them serve as signs to mark sacred times and days and years, and let them be lights in the vault of the sky to give light on the earth." And it was so. God made two lights, the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night. He also made the stars. God set them in the vault of the sky and gave light on the earth to govern the day and the night and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, "Let the water teem with living creatures. Let the birds fly above the earth across the vault of the sky." So God created the great creatures of the sea and every living thing with which the water teems and that moves about in it according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them and said, "Be fruitful and increase in number and fill the water of the seas and let the birds increase on the earth." And there was evening and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, "Let the land produce creatures according to their kinds, the livestock, the creatures that move along the ground, and the wild animals, each according to its kind." And it was so. God made the wild animals according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kinds, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground." Then God said, "I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth and all the birds of the sky and all the creatures that move along the ground, everything that has breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food." Thus the heavens and the earth were completed in all their vast array. By the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work. Then God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it he rested from all the work of creating that he had done. This is the account of the heavens and the earth when they were created, when the Lord God made the earth and the heavens. The word of the Lord.
You know, Pastor Joe told me before the service that if I keep putting people to sleep with my teaching, he's going to turn the lights off. I just didn't know that he was serious and the power that he had. Just a sign of our increasing friendship, Joe. It's a gift. Hey, morning, everybody. If I didn't get to meet you at the beginning of the service, my name is Steve Turnbull. I'm your senior pastor here at UALC, and really grateful to have the chance to talk to you about this passage that we just heard this morning, and also really prayerful that I will get the chance to talk to you about this passage that we just heard this morning. It is a beautiful passage. It is a complex passage. It is an artistic passage. It's got layer after layer, side after side, theme after theme, topic after topic. We could go on. We could do months. I'm not gonna this morning, but we could go on. We could do months and never exhaust all the things that are taught to us and represented to us in that passage. But among all those things, surely one of the central ideas, surely one of the things most intended to be gotten across to us is the beauty and the power and the effect of God's word. Or I might even say God's words, God's speech. As you heard Pastor Joe say in the children's sermon this morning, there's this rhythm. And you almost have to read this chapter maybe more than once to pick up all of it or see it laid out in one of those ancient technological wonders with the pages, like the books, I think they were called once upon a time. Remember those things? You see it all laid out on the page, and there's this repetition and this rhythm. And God said, and it was so, and God saw that it was good. And God said, and it was so, and God saw that it was good. And God said, and it was so, and God saw that it was good. As you read along the passage, it like picks up speed like a boulder rolling downhill. There's this rhythm and this accumulating beauty and power to it. And when you hear it, and you hear the poetry of it, you can really feel this praise, this description of God's word. But as I read over this and reflected on it in preparation for today, I could feel and see something else too. And that is the distance between this experience and the experience that most of us have with words in our world. All the words that we hear all the time. And how many words do you hear every day? They are coming at us a million miles an hour. Those of you who are teenagers, children, young adults, you are the most marketed to generation in history. You hear so many advertising words that come at you all the time. Think about how these words, these probably most common words that we hear all the time, the way that they work on us. In fact, some of our younger generations even say they struggle, maybe you have felt this way, struggle with feeling cynical, feeling like somebody is just always trying to sell you something all the time, anytime they're talking to you. And if you have felt that way, you're not crazy. Actually, it's almost like somebody is trying to sell you something all the time. You're so marketed to all the time. And the consistent messaging in these words that all of us hear so much of our lives, the consistent message is so different from the repetition of what we just heard in God's word. The consistent message in these words that we hear all the time is not good, not good, not good. Your car is not good. Your house, not good enough. Your skin, not good. Your body, not good. All the things you own, not good enough. When you get to be my age, your yard is not good enough. Your financial advisor, not good enough, right? I listen to a lot of sports radio. All the things I learned that are wrong with my life when I listen to the commercials. Do this sometime if you want to feel bad about yourself. Take stock of like a 2 or 3 or 5 minute commercial break and make a list of all the things that's wrong with you now, you know? And these messages are meant to control us. They are meant to produce a specific consumer reaction, right? Not good, not good, not good, but wait, there's hope for only $19.99. Or nowadays, the methods are actually getting better and better. For just $13.99 a month, if you will give us your credit card, and then you'll forget to cancel it, and a year and a half later, you'll go, why am I still paying for that thing? And the words are meant to control us based on what we now think is wrong with us, right? to manipulate a specific action. So different, by the way. I don't know if you noticed this one little piece in the Genesis reading, but it's staggering once you see it. The Word of God doesn't control us. The Word of God frees us and empowers us to join with God. It's kind of staggering. God speaks to plants. God speaks to fish. God speaks to animals, and God speaks to humans and empowers us to join Him in His act of creation. He makes His creatures to be created co-creators in the world of creation. What an incredible, empowering Word of God. Or think about a special class of advertising words that we hear, political advertisements, or sometimes news, which I can't always tell the difference between news and advertisements anymore. They've gotten real close to each other. Used to be that there was like a lull. Used to be these words would shut off for a little while in between cycles, but they get a little softer, except for the yard signs, at least in the place where I live. Have you noticed? Yard signs, turns out, are extremely godly. They have obeyed the command of God to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. Or so it is in my neighborhood anyway. I've been trying to find a spot somewhere where I can't turn around and see one, but I haven't found the spot in my neighborhood yet. But it works the same way. Not good. Not good. Not good. I had to fly recently. First time I've been on an airplane in about a year and a half, and I was flying back and forth to the Twin Cities in Minnesota, where I lived for a long time. And on the way back, I had an aisle seat, which, by the way, I saw, and it was very good. And I was kind of long legs out there. So I was on aisle seat, and I noticed the guy who was across the aisle from me and one row up was watching some TV on his seat back television. I just hope we never get used to the phrase seat back television. But he's watching some news on his seat back television, and the flight attendants warned us how filthy those things are, by the way. Anyway. And he was watching some political news channel. And I was listening to a podcast, which means I had nothing to do with my eyes. I just was like looking around, right? I wasn't watching anything. And the power of screens to just draw your attention every time a new image flashes. And so I didn't really want to watch TV or anything, but I just kept looking over there like some kind of trained robot. I'm looking over at the images that are flashing one after another. And I don't think I'm exaggerating. I could be wrong by one or two, but I think I'm being literally accurate that 100% of the headlines that he saw changing every 15 seconds for an hour and a half were all negative. Every single one that I saw was about what this person is doing wrong and how they're lying and how they're dumb and how this is an impending disaster and how this is going to be doom. And I just thought, like, in just an hour or an hour and a half, what do those words do to you? And that's not the only hour that any of us have spent taking in those words. Not good, not good, not good. Fear, 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 threat, 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 other people, other people, other people. It's so formative. These words that we hear all the time, coming from lots of different places, are designed to control us in certain ways, to make us more loyal, active consumers, angrier partisans, something like this, so different from the character of the Word of God. And I'm not making this up, by the way. This is always the way that Genesis 1 has worked. When God's people have read Genesis 1 and heard these words, they have always been countercultural words of God, always carving out space like a garden in a wilderness, if you will. You can read other stories. The ancient Israelites who read this story and told this story and handed it down generation to generation were aware of other stories that were at work in their world, other words that said other things about God and truth and the nature of people and the nature of the world. How power works. There are other stories that talk about how the gods created the worlds and how that happened by accident. There's one great story of how it happened when one god killed another god and stretched out their body and made the world out of it once the person or the god was dead. That's a beautiful thought. And how human beings were just kind of an accidental afterthought made to feed the gods, take care of the gods' needs for crops and so forth. And they talk about how kings and dynasties, sometimes particular kings and dynasties, were created in the image of the gods. And that, of course, is meant to legitimate the rule of the kings. How different, how countercultural, how different is the image and the effect of the words that say that God is so powerful and so beautiful that he would do the work of an artist and his word would just speak and call forth things into being. How different when human beings are made on purpose by the good purposes of God. How different if all human beings, male and female alike, are created in the image of God. So different than if just the kings and rulers are created in the image of God. If you believed something like that, it would have an effect on you. It would change your own life. It would change your relationships. It would change your culture. If you believed every human being was created in the image of God, you might believe that they were endowed by their creator with certain kinds of unalienable rights. And this would create the notion of human rights. It shapes the way that we live. But I want to point out that these words that fill our ears all the time are not only different from the words of God, but they are also so numerous. There's just so many of them, and they are so loud. They're not only different in character from the Word of God, but in most of our lives, in many of our lives, I think my own included, they even outnumber the Word of God. There's just so much time and space for them as they force their way in. And it's striking to me that in the Bible already, like 3,500 years ago, lived a man named Moses, who was a leader and a teacher for the ancient Israelites. And in the book of Deuteronomy, which is like four books after the book of Genesis, Moses is teaching the Israelites to love this God, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and strength. And then he teaches them a little bit about what that means and teaches them to reflect on these words, to learn the words of God, and to reflect on them in your homes, to talk about them when you get up in the morning, to talk about them when you lie down in the evening, to talk about them when you're traveling on the road, and also again when you're home. And if you're in families and if you have children, talk about them with your household and impress them upon your children. And it strikes me that Moses did not have to deal with 1% of the social media storm that we do. And yet already, the urgency of hearing God's word was apparent. And already, Moses and the Israelites were aware of the formative effect of the words that we take in, what they do to us. Let me push this one step further. Not only are the words that we take in so different from the words of God, and they represent truth and life so differently, and not only are they just in general more numerous and so loud in our lives, but I find that increasingly, these other words, other messages, other priorities, if you will, other truths, are competing for the very spaces in our lives where we used to receive the gift of hearing and receiving God's word. And I think about it at an individual level, where maybe there might have been space, or maybe there would be space in our lives to get up in the morning or retreat or sit down in your chair in the evening with a cup of coffee or tea or something and maybe have some time to read scripture or pray or think or reflect or meditate. And now, at least for so many of us, we wake up in the morning, the first thing we have to do is silence the alarm that's on the control device that we call our phones and start taking in whatever information, notifications, social media, news in the morning. Maybe we're getting tired in the evening, and maybe that used to be time for some conversation or some reflection on the day or some meditation, perhaps, and now we binge Netflix or Hulu or something until our brains are so addled we can barely rest and sleep. I just think about the cumulative effect of these things on us. I know two people, one a close friend, one a more distant acquaintance, who talked about just some of the rhythms they've had to set up for themselves to try to receive and hear the words of God in the midst of the storm of other words. One of my friends has a little pattern he made for himself. He said, I'm not allowed to open my, I won't open my phone until I've opened my Bible first. I have to open my Bible before I open my phone. It's just not a bad little rhythm he made for himself. Another person was talking about just the distressing impact he's noticing, the rising anxiety in his life, and said, I just have to make this rhythm for myself. I have to do morning prayers before morning news. He's like, I'll do both. I want both, but I have to do it in that order or I'm just off on the wrong foot in my whole life. Or I think about the way that these other words and other priorities compete for the one space that Christians have reserved for thousands of years for hearing and receiving the Word of God. And I'm talking about gathered worship together on the Lord's Day. For those of you who are tuned in right now and those of you who are joining us in person, we set this time aside to hear and receive and be formed by the Word of God. For centuries, when most people, including most Christians, were illiterate, never could have read the Bible, couldn't read their prayer book themselves, maybe had a few things they could recite, still they would gather together and see the images that are in sacred spaces and hear the Word of God and be formed by it together. But now there's so much competition for this, and you feel it, and I feel it. I'm raising teenagers, maybe especially if you have younger children or teenagers in your family, so many activities, so many things competing for the time in our lives. And man, if you're in that space, I totally sympathize with you. We get it. I understand. I'm grieving early. I'm already grieving that I'm gonna have to make a choice if I want to see my daughter's high school graduation in about half a year, which is scheduled for prime hour on Sunday morning, right? And I'm just, I guess people didn't know that. I thought it was common knowledge. I'm just grieved about that. I'm just sad about that, and I recognize that there are costs that come with those kinds of things. All right, I've complained enough. Let me ask you. Let me ask you to think about this from a different angle. What would you do? Let me ask you, what do you do? when the words are yours that nobody's listening to? What do you do when you're trying to talk and somebody's talking over you and interrupting you and ignoring you and you can't get a word in edgewise? That ever happened to anybody before? What do you do? Maybe a variety of things, right? Maybe it depends on the situation. Maybe try to talk a little bit louder over somebody else or get in a little faster before the next person can start talking to you and get your word in. Or maybe different personality, different circumstance, just kind of throw up your hands and lean back and go, whatever, nobody cares anyway. I'm not going to waste my breath. Many a parent, why should I waste my breath trying to talk right now? I don't know. It could be a lot of different things. What would you do? God sent his son. God sent his son. God so loved the world. God so loved the sinful, stubborn, unlistening, over-talking world that he sent his son. The Gospel of John begins this way. We're going to read the Gospel of John together later this year. It begins this way. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. And through him, all things were made. But we haven't been listening. The people of God weren't listening. And so, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen him, and he has made God known to us. God sent his Son. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And it is hard to overestimate. It is impossible to overestimate the difference and the impact and the meaning and the hopefulness that comes from that truth. That God would not throw up his hands and give up on us, but instead would send his Son, the Word made flesh, into our lives. And I don't mean that the hopefulness cannot be overestimated, can be said, simply because this Word is just all like light and rainbows all the time. I don't mean that the Word of God made flesh is naive and doesn't see the not good in our lives. In fact, the Word of God made flesh sees and says the not good in our lives even more truly, with more truth and with more power, with more diagnostic effect than all of the other shallow negativity that fills our word diets all the time. Because the Word of God did not come to say, your car is not good, your skin is not good, your clothes are not good. But the Word of God made flesh come and helps us to admit and see that our relationships with one another have become not good. The Word of God made flesh comes to help us see and admit that our hearts are not good, and that our very relationships with God have been broken by sin and become not good. And then we have to ask ourselves, what are you going to buy to fix that? Nothing, right? You can't buy anything to fix that. And that, I think, is why nobody's talking about it, because nobody can sell you a solution to that. We don't have a solution to that. But Jesus does. Thank God. But Jesus does. And his solution to all the not good in our lives begins with forgiving it. Jesus' solution to all the not good in our lives begins with forgiving all the not good in our lives and making us good. Thanks be to God. Jesus doesn't need to manipulate us. He doesn't need to control us by means of the insecurities and the anxieties and the emptiness and the need in our lives. He doesn't need any of that, because Jesus is the Word of God made flesh, who can come to us, see the not good in our lives, forgive it all, and begin the work of making us good. To do the work that the Word in the beginning did in the first place. When all things were made by the Word, Jesus' solution is now to do the work of Genesis 1 over again. To begin a work of new creation in our lives. Thanks be to God. Anybody but me also need that? I need that more than I need anything else. Let me tell you about my last week for a second. Last Sunday, for reasons I can't entirely explain, I started to have a pretty rough day. After worship, we got in the car in the afternoon, and we drove with my daughter to go do a college visit. I have a high school senior, my daughter, and we went off to do a college visit. And honestly, just kind of through the afternoon and evening as I was driving, I was feeling pretty discouraged and anxious in ways that I usually don't. And I was kind of beating myself up a little bit, speaking my own words of not good. I wasn't very happy with the way that I had taught on Sunday morning and just the stuff that we can do to ourselves, you know. And that evening we stopped for dinner, and even my daughter is like, you okay, Dad? It's very sweet of her to ask. And, you know, we had dinner and I slept okay at night. It was all fine. And I got up in the morning, as is my habit. I'm a morning person, and I'm kind of trained that I get up a couple hours before anybody else does. And I went down into the hotel lobby and was reading my Bible and doing my morning prayers, and unfortunately couldn't get the music, all the noise and all the words just wouldn't stop. But I forgot to bring my prayer book with me because I was traveling, but fortunately I do the same prayers almost all the time, so they're in my head anyway. And I said my morning prayers, and I was reading from the Gospel of John, because like I said, we're going to read that together later this year, and it seemed wise to me that I would spend my devotional time in John for a while this fall before I begin to teach it in the winter. And I was reading in John chapter 8 in particular, and God used some specific words there from Jesus, the truth that if the Son sets you free, you shall be free indeed. And I got to hear some good news of Jesus' liberation, reading from the Scriptures, and his work of healing and freeing in my heart. And then wouldn't you know it, a little bit later that morning, we went to a chapel service at one of the colleges that we were visiting. And it's a pretty brief, simple service in between morning classes. And just one of the worship songs that we sang together, God used to do some healing and freeing in my heart. And I realized that just on Sunday morning, I'd been preaching the gospel and sharing the good news of Jesus' grace and forgiveness and power to make us new, but I was talking, I just wasn't listening. I wasn't hearing it for myself. And sometimes it can be a little bit hard when you're the one up front to also hear it for yourself. And God worked through his word, thanks be to God. Just begin a work of forgiving, healing, renewing, refreshing, and strengthening for me. Am I the only one who needs that, or do you need that too? Because man, I need that more than anything else. And if that is what you need, then I just would encourage you, ask you to think about all the words that you are hearing, all the messages that are coming into your ears. If we are what we eat, what the diet of words is doing in your life, and what words you hear most of the time, and what those words are doing to you. And are those words moving you in the direction of freedom and joy and hope and peace and life and love for one another and community and God? And if they are, lean into that. Receive more of that word in your life. And if they are not leading you in the direction of joy and hope and peace and life and community and love for one another and God, then maybe find a way to listen to less of that. Maybe find a way to be less deformed by those words in your life. Now, I just want to tell one story to try to clarify something that I don't mean. About 5 years ago, I was walking alongside in life with a guy who was a part of my old church and a friend that had kind of became part of a small group of guys together. And he was rediscovering faith again for the first time in his life. I had been kind of raised in the church, but was discovering a living relationship following Jesus. He was reading this Christian book that somebody had recommended to him, and he asked me if I would read it with him. And I happily did that, and we kind of got partway into it. And the book has a really, I would say, rigid, pretty heavy prescription for if you're a real Christian, if you're an actual disciple and follower of Jesus, this is how you'll do this, and this is the way that real Christians read their Bibles in the morning and pray in the morning and all that kind of stuff. And he'd been through some tough stuff in his life and been through some failures, and he said, Pastor Steve, I can't keep reading this thing. It's just killing me. I mean, it just makes me feel like a failure over and over again for not living up to the expectations of this program here. And all I could say is, man, I don't think that's what Jesus wants for you in the life that he's giving you. When I say, what are we listening to and where can there be space in our lives for hearing more of God's word, what I'm not saying is all Christians are morning people. And you get up a half an hour before everybody else in your home. I've always wondered how that would work, by the way, if everybody in your home got up half an hour before everybody else to have that time. That actually does work for me because I am the biggest morning person in my family. It could be any variety of ways, and as Christians, I think we have the freedom to find the ways, but the question is to ask, how will we hear the life-giving, good words of God in our lives? And for you, maybe you just recognize one of the places where I hear the words that do other things to me is when I watch too much news in the evening or the morning or the afternoon or I don't know what, and sometimes when I'm doing that, I think I'll just flip on some Christian music instead. I'll flip that off and listen to something else instead. Or maybe while you're looking at all the images on Instagram and Facebook that are reminding you of everybody else's perfect life that you don't have, and it's all just a lie. I mean, maybe just uninstall that and flip open a Bible app and read some of God's word instead. I know nobody's actually going to do that, but it's kind of an interesting idea. Maybe the UALC mobile app, and I'm not just trying to sell you something. I get no cut when that's downloaded, I promise. But members of our congregation write devotional reflections that are based on Bible readings that are connected to our Sunday morning readings, and it's a way that we kind of encourage one another in our faith with the words that lead us to life. And together as a community, we support one another in God's word this way. We support one another in small groups, and we talked about that at the beginning in our announcements this morning. That's an opportunity where we help tune one another's hearts to hear the words of God that give us life. And when we gather together on Sunday mornings, we build our worship around the Word of God. From the words of our prayers and the words of our confession and the words of our songs to short little Bible readings like the one that we had today, to sermons that unpack and apply God's Word to our lives, to coming to the Lord's table and gathering around the Word that is given to us, not only that we would hear it with our ears, but also taste it and smell it and touch it and be convinced and be reminded and encouraged that it is indeed true and real. And I encourage you to make it a priority in your life to be a part of that. Here, beginning this fall, we're doing the same thing we've done for the last 3 years, starting the series we call Open Book, where in the fall we open the book right there around the beginning, and we spend the year reading our way through, and every year we track a little different theme or a storyline that we would be formed over and over again in the life-giving, good Word of God. And when I invite you to engage with that and make a priority of participating in that together with one another, to hear the Word of God and to build one another up, just to be realistic, I know how hard that is. I said already, we understand that in our own family. And I understand that every single week, whether it's Sunday morning or Saturday night or during the week or when you fill out your calendar for the fall, there are 1,000 messages that are very well funded and very well marketed and very well systematized that are trying to convince you that there is something else much more important to do with this hour than to be here. And statistically speaking, I know that there's a whole lot of us who will have something more important to do next week, and that honestly less than half of our church will ever even hear me share this message. This is the competition for the Word of God in our world. I get it, and I'm not beating anybody up. We get it. We're fighting with the two on every front. I just also know that Jesus loves you. I know that Jesus loves you, and he loves his people, and he loves his church. And he wants to form us for the life that is truly life. And he wants to form us together to be a community where joy can flourish and love can grow. And that the Word of God is powerful and effective. And when God speaks, it becomes so. And behold, it becomes very, very good. And so for just these same reasons, we are going to go to the Lord's table right now. And we are going to receive the promise of the Word made flesh in our flesh. And we're going to be reminded of how God's Word promises to us and creates the forgiveness of our many sins, thanks be to God, and knits us together into a community, welcomes us to the Father's table, creates us in one family, and strengthens us and nourishes us for life with Jesus, all the places that he sends us and leads us.